Despite the inability for most of us to hit the trails with our mates, given the current world situation, some might still be in the market for a new mid-travel bike, of which the Forbidden Druid is a worthy contender. This high-end, low-volume bike brand, named after the Forbidden Plateau in Cumberland, BC, features a high single-pivot suspension design that is more typically used on downhill bikes, and today I'm going to be looking at this design in detail to let you know what I think of it. Before proceeding, I want to give a shout-out to all those who have joined me on Patreon to help me decide which bike to feature next, and provide some much-needed support to the channel. Thanks, everyone! Looking at the anti-rise, you'll notice linearly decreasing values from just under 130% to around 100%. What this translates to is a suspension that will either remain very level, or even squat down a bit during rear braking, which can be a beneficial trait for steeper trails where you don't want to be pitched over the bars. On the flip side, this suspension won't be as active as those with lower anti-rise values. Switching over to anti-squat had me researching various articles and textbooks to try and ensure that I was analyzing the forces correctly. Unlike most bikes, where the chain forces are directly from the rear cassette to the front chainring, the forces on the rear swing arm in this circumstance is instead between the chain idler and the main chainring, due to the idler being mounted on the swing arm. As a result of this placement, the anti-squat values are almost identical to those for anti-rise. Overall, the high anti-squat values will result in excellent pedaling efficiency with no pedal bob. And while normally I would harp on about high anti-squat causing pedal kickback, you'll soon find out that there are no anticipated negatives of this high anti-squat due to the idler. Turning now to the kinematics of the suspension design, one will notice a nicely progressive response. However, rather than just a linearly decreasing leverage ratio, the designers instead tweaked the curve using a linkage between the rear swing arm and the rear shock to ensure an ideal suspension response. During the first part of the travel, you'll notice that the response is more progressive, with a higher starting leverage ratio and consequently better small bump compliance. As you get deeper in the travel, there is a slightly less progressive response to ensure that the forces don't ramp up too quickly, which can result in a harsher response on bigger impacts. Finally, deep in the travel, the progressivity increases again to aid in the bottom out prevention on big hits. Overall, I'm really impressed with this curve, which should provide an excellently responding 130mm of travel. The final thing to look at is the wheel path and chain growth of the Druid, which are certainly one of the most unique aspects compared to any bike I've looked at so far. As a result of the high pivot, the wheel path is very rearward. This means that the suspension won't get hung up on square edge hits as much, allowing the rider to maintain their speed better down rough tracks and rock gardens. However, despite this rearward wheel path, the chain growth is only around 8mm or 1.3%, significantly less than any other design. This is going to equate to almost no pedal kickback and a very active rear end. It should come as no surprise to you that I really like the suspension design. The combination of level braking, excellent pedaling efficiency, a nicely progressive leverage ratio, a rearward axle path, and very low chain growth leads to a very desirable product. Before I can conclude, I should point out some notables with this bike that are somewhat unrelated to the numbers. Firstly, high idlers are another source of friction that, like anything else, can make pedaling less efficient if not maintained. The high idler also means you're going to have to order longer chains than normal. Secondly, the placement of the chain so close to the seat stay can result in chain slap, making for a noisier ride than a more conventional design. Third, the designers took time to make different chain stay lengths based on the size of the bike to ensure a more balanced weight distribution. Finally, as of right now, this bike is only available as a frame set from the manufacturer. There are likely stores who are building up complete bikes, but A, I can't guarantee that you'll find one, and B, they're likely not going to come cheap. Thanks for sticking it out to the end of this video. If you haven't already, make sure to subscribe to the channel and like the video to let me know that you like what I'm doing on this channel. And remember, if you want to be a part of the recurring polls to vote on which bike to look at next, make sure to head over to my Patreon page using the link down below. Until next time, keep your distance, and remember that biking with buddies will happen again, hopefully sooner rather than later.